Are one of the 10 highest grossing art house theaters in the country. And in the region, we are higher grossing than the Ritzes, than any of the art houses in this region. There have been many predictions that the movie theaters would cease to exist. From the days when it went from silent to sound, people said, nobody's going to like sound. When TV came in the 50s, nobody's going to come out of their house to watch a movie. I think if we make the experience enjoyable, there will always be an audience in our theaters. There are other places you can see movies now, and many people, particularly young people, are what I call platform promiscuous. They don't care if they watch a movie on their watch face that's this big or on a screen that's much, much bigger. However, they will, I hope, learn the special experience of coming to a theater to watch a movie, and I hope they will become the audience of the future. We have not, every year our revenues have gone up, so we have not suffered any battering by these other platforms that I can account for anyway.
Probably more often than not, I watch movies at home before I watch them in a theater, to be frank.
I do think some movies are especially more suitable for theater viewing, just due to the scale, or an epic movie like 2001 or Lawrence of Arabia. Those fit very well in a theater, as opposed to some other movies, maybe a comedy or maybe a drama that would still work very well at home. Yeah, viewing a movie on a phone just seems like the viewer would not be respecting the work that went into it enough. If you think about hours put in, all the people who worked on it, just to watch it on a small little device, it seems sort of flippant with the movie watching experience, you know? When I think that's probably more a time-killing thing instead of actually appreciating the art that went into the movie and taking the time to pay attention. It seems like details would be lost on the phone, and just having to hold it up, it's not as good an experience.
I kind of look down on it when I see people watching movies on their phones, because it seems really small and you won't enjoy it as much. But I have done that before if I was if I was in a place like my plane got delayed, or if I was stuck somewhere, then I have done that. And if depending on the movie, I have enjoyed it. If it's a movie that's like a comedy, or a movie that isn't something where I want to see a big screen, not like a big action movie or a big beautifully shot movie, then I don't mind it as much. But there is something nice about going to the theater. Like, it's something I look forward to. I probably go like once a week, like sometimes twice a week, but so it is enjoyable to me.
I think we're all conscious of the fact that we will need to attract new audiences in order to stay around. I have a slightly different take on it, though. I see young people, such as yourself, very open to seeing films in theaters when they feel comfortable and when they have the time and when they're aware of them. I guess what I think about young people in my own family who I find, if they see the right film, like say a classic film, the first time my son saw Casablanca, he was so excited. So I think these are films, the really good films, that can be rediscovered generation after generation. And I don't know, I just have a great faith in young people that even though they may find Casablanca on their iPhone or YouTube or someplace like that, that they will eventually, or they would enjoy coming to a theater and seeing it there. And they're smart enough, savvy enough to realize the difference in the experience of seeing it, you know, possibly on 35 millimeter in a theater. And I think the challenging part is just getting them here. And I know how busy young people are. But on a summer evening, encourage your friends to come during the summer when we're playing the classic films, and you will be hooked.
There's a huge difference for me between seeing a movie like on what they call the silver screen versus, you know, in my own home. I think part of it is like when we're out in like human beings at their core are social creatures, and I feel like there's this sort of like this politeness and sort of like this there's something to be said for like going out to a movie theater, being with other people, and like really like everyone sort of like enjoying it, and like, you know, you have like, at some movie theaters, you have a little bit more of a personal relationship. There's maybe a little bit of heckling, you know, maybe there's a little bit of like, you know, like, at the very least, there's some clapping at the end, depending on the theater. And there's something of that, like, interpersonality, but that's something that I don't feel as much when I'm at home. Another thing is, when I'm at home, I get very distracted by other things when I'm watching a movie. But like, when I find myself a lot more focused on the movie when I'm in the theater, and, you know, it's like big and like it's what I'm watching.
Well, you know, this is a classic example of cost-benefit analysis. In other words, there are trade-offs here. On the one hand, I'm delighted that we now have these technologies that make film viewing easy and portable and transportable around the world in a way that people could never have anticipated or appreciated 30, 40, 50 years ago. You know, going to see a classic film was really an epic journey, and if you didn't catch it in its original release, or you didn't catch it in repertory movie theaters or on television in reruns, at which point it probably was chopped up anyway, you really just missed out, and you would probably have to go to film school to watch a lot of things that now, for the most part, you can bring up on a tiny little device. So from the standpoint of access, I think the technology has been terrific. But on the other side of that equation is the fact that we're often watching movies now in a format and a reduced screen size that doesn't capture the original spectacle of movies that were intended to be screened for a communal audience on a very large movie theater screen. So that kind of theatrical dimension in the sense of classical theater, right? That classical theatrical dimension of film going gets lost when everything can be equally reduced to the small screen of your iPhone or your computer. I know people are filling their homes with large screen televisions and are getting an approximation of theatrical spectacle in their homes, but it really isn't the same thing as going to a movie theater. And I don't mean that just because of a movie theater's size or technology or audio system, but also that essential human element of watching with other people and feeling the energy of the audience in the room, whether it's a terrific movie, a horrible movie, or whatever it is. There is something to be gained from that communal experience that might get lost if we all get atomized and privatized into our own personal viewing experience.
You know, I think it's like any cultural center in a way. Our communities, especially as we become more kind of living in a digital world where everything happens via Facebook or Twitter or text or phone, it's important not only to see films, but to have spaces where people gather. So whether that's a church or a cinema or a museum, you know, but these places where you can have kind of a communal experience, I think, are really important.
We have to put up the marquee, so we start our schedule on Fridays for movie theaters. So we have 3 new films coming.
Petty.
I call her Patty.
Maybe Peggy. Peggy. Yeah, Peggy Guggen, I have an hologram.
So how do you decide what goes where in the
marquee?
Well,
it depends. If the title's really long, then we'll put it in whatever space is biggest. Like, see, the middle spaces are the shortest. So we'll put it miles ahead up here. That's short. There's not a very interesting process to it. It's more just like...
I thought you were going to say, like, how do you choose the films you get?
So we have a sort of a programming team who selects those. We have a film booker who works with a lot of art house movie theaters all over the country. And he gives us suggestions and kind of apprises us of, like, what's coming up and what might be of interest to us. But we also will let him know of things that we're interested in as well that might not be on his list. And so then Juliet and I work together in sort of picking through those films. And a lot of times I will have to go to and the distributors or the studios will set up early trade screenings for industry people so that you can view the movies ahead of time and make your decision based on, you know, more information, really. So, you know, there's a lot that goes into it. The choice is sometimes harder than sometimes there's slim pickings, and then there's sometimes too much to pick from, and then people will complain, why didn't you get this movie? And we're like, well, we had to pick this one over this one. So, you know, I think that's what's the hardest part of it.
This is my neighborhood movie theater. This is where I mostly go to see films. So for me, being living in suburbia, you don't always expect to have a theater where you can go to see anything other than sort of the blockbuster standard Hollywood stuff. So I really appreciate that I do have somewhere to come where I've got the kind of films that I'm actually interested in seeing close enough that I can actually hop on my bike and come over here or walk over here. So that's me as an individual. As a filmmaker and a college professor, what's been really lovely is that Haverford College has a relationship now with the Bryn Mawr Film Institute, and we are able to do this Strange Truth series where we can actually screen films here, and the facilities here are so fantastic. So to be able to show a film like Natalia's film El Velador here, it's just a completely different viewing experience for our students and for the public than it would be if it were at the college. So that's a fantastic thing that the theater brings to the local community.
Most of the students I encounter are going to be around 18, 19, 20 years old. Although at BMFI I teach an older audience generally. But I think the virtue of teaching younger people is that they come to film studies without a lot of preconceptions, but they have a lot of experience. And by experience, I mean they've been watching movies and television and watching things on YouTube now pretty much their entire, you know, conscious lives. And while they have all that experience absorbing moving images, they don't have a lot of time and training to reflect on what they're watching and absorbing. So I think my job is to kind of facilitate for them a new, more self-conscious, more thoughtful way of engaging with the moving image.
When I first started here, it was mainly just keeping staff in place and making sure 35mm film projectors work, and those things are pretty easy to put together. But my main responsibilities obviously range from anything, making sure that the projectors are working the way they're supposed to be working. We want to, and you know, we want the theater experience to be as good as it can be. Make sure the projectors are good quality image on screen and the sound is as perfect as it can be. But at the same time, it's also managing a staff of 15 to 20 people that they're where they're supposed to be. Making sure that they're either in concession, you know, giving the best service that they can be and greeting our customers as they walk in, or box office, selling tickets, and then answering all the millions of questions they get every day. So it's a little bit of managing people, but also managing technology. And it's also managing the things that you don't necessarily think about, like the concession stand menu board, making sure all the information is correct on that. Making sure tickets are set up properly in the ticketing system. Overall, kind of being a face for the theater, because while our staff is on the floor, I think all of our staff is the face of the theater, and making sure we have our best face forward, so to speak. Making sure that everyone's where they're supposed to be, that they're properly dressed, and that they have a good working relationship with the customers, because without the customers, we wouldn't be here, and they're they are the face of the theaters.
There is pressure to show more commercial movies. However, most of our audience really values the thoughtful movies that we prefer to show. And they come here often not even knowing what movie they're going to see, just trusting that we've chosen four good movies for them to see, and they go to one of them. And they come here to see our midweek special films, which are even more esoteric in some cases, or they might be old repertory films that we love showing and our audience loves to see. But there is pressure to, from time to time, if our revenues are sagging, we will bring in a movie that has somewhat more popular appeal, but that does not conflict with our mission, because we're mission-driven, not financially driven. And at the end of every year, we end up in the black. That means we have surplus funds left over at the end of the year, but no one takes them. Unlike a for-profit, if this were a commercial for-profit movie theater, the owner would keep whatever's left over at the end of the year. In our case, we don't do that. We put it back into the building or into the educational programming or into the other community activities that we do.
I think Bryn Mawr Film Institute gives back in a number of ways. I think, as I mentioned before, by fulfilling our mission, which is to use film as entertainment and also a way to educate and enlighten people, to make film something more than simple entertainment the way it is at most of the big box theaters. We use it as a way to bring people together. We use it for provoking thought and discussion around topical films. So we give back largely by just doing our mission, fulfilling our mission. But we also provide a sort of continuity that I think people value. Many of our patrons have been coming to this theater, to this building, for decades, and appreciate the fact that it's still here and they can bring their children and their grandchildren, and that it's still a viable place, that it's found a way to adapt to new audiences, to new economic realities, to new civic realities as the town around us changes.